We welcome all of you to the NorthCap University Masterclass Series, where eminent thinkers, prominent industrialists, honorable judges, renowned lawyers, and members of the academia are invited to deliver talks on various disciplines such as engineering, management, law, including other subjects for the benefit of the students and the faculty of the NorthCap University. Ever since its inception, about 25 years ago, the NorthCap University has grown and developed into one of the finest universities of our country. The university offers comprehensive courses in engineering, management, and law, with specifications and specializations in areas of artificial intelligence, virtual reality, gaming, cloud computing, business analysis, law, and jurisprudence. We are proud to say today that many of our alumni have joined excellent jobs at many global companies in India and abroad. Being powered by the Arizona State University recently, the NorthCap University is spreading its wings far and wide, not only at the national level, but also at the international level. This evening, we have amongst us Meghna Mishra, a very bright and dynamic lawyer who is a partner with the well-known law firm Karanjawala and Company. On behalf of the management and the entire community of the NorthCap University, I take immense pleasure to welcome Meghna Mishra as the speaker to today's seminar. Meghna obtained her legal education from the Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. Having practiced law for over 20 years, she has carved out for herself a prominent position in the legal profession. Over the years, Meghna has blossomed into a very competent lawyer, having handled a variety of cases relating to commercial matters, property disputes, family disputes, intellectual property matters, and also matters which come under alternative dispute resolution system. Her clients have mostly come from the corporate sector. Thus, she settled matters for DLF, Go Air, the Sindhias, Ratan and Tata, the Adbani Groups, the Hero Motor Corporation Limited, Sri Education Trust, the Hindustan Times, among others. Meghna's capability as a meticulous and a committed lawyer is evident from the number of awards that she's received in the recent past. To name a few, she's received the Corporate USA Today Award, the Lawyers International Legal 100 Award, the M&A Today Award, the Global Venture Award, and several others. Meghna has developed outstanding skills in the area of alternate dispute resolution. In a short while, she'll be speaking on the topic alternate dispute resolution. Is it the way forward? Alternate dispute resolution, popularly known as ADR, refers to a range of dispute settlement methods which help the parties in the dispute to come to a settlement without going to a court or without litigating on the said matter. With the increased burden on courts due to pending cases, coupled with the high cost of litigation and delay in justice, I think alternate dispute resolution will offer a lot of hope to the litigants. Meghna will be speaking about what exactly alternate dispute resolution system is and the merits and demerits of the system. I request Meghna to come and deliver her talk. Thank you so much. Over to Meghna.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a warm welcome. It's a great privilege to share the platform with you. And good morning, everybody who's taken the time out to attend today's session. Since we are on a virtual platform, I can't see, and I hope, if anyone has any questions, we can address them at the end of the session after I conclude. I would like to start by just briefly discussing, what is a dispute? Because dispute has been known to mankind from time immemorial. even our epics, our Mahabharata and Ramayana, they revolve around disputes and the resolution thereof. I am a mother of two children, and so I often act as a referee. If there is a bar of chocolate which needs to be shared between two children, then it can be something so trivial. And then you are acting as a mediator or a referee trying to resolve that little conflict. Now put this in a larger perspective. This could be a dispute with your neighbor on parking. If you're working in a company, it could be in relation to your IPR, a trademark or a patent. And so I would say that a conflict or dispute itself, now that is a part of our life. And what is important is that these disputes, how do we approach it or how are we to handle it? I would like to quote our Honorable Chief Justice, Mr. N.V. Ramanna, who said that dispute resolution through mediation was part of the tradition of our country. India and numerous Asian countries have a long tradition of collaborative and amicable settlement of disputes. Mediation as a concept is deeply embedded in the Indian ethos. Negotiation techniques are central to resolving conflict. And as a basic technique, these have been around for many thousands of years. As ma'am mentioned, ADR refers to these various techniques which we adopt, which are designed to resolve the controversies in issue more effectively than in the court procedure, which can be much longer. And it is a good alternative to the formal legal system that we have. So I wonder how many of you have actually seen a court proceeding. So there's that famous dialogue, tariq par tariq. But when you actually live through a litigation, when you experience this firsthand, and this I say from firsthand experience, when I see that if a lawyer has a ongoing litigation in court, then the same procedural delays in the system, which we accept as part of the game and we tell our clients, the same thing starts pinching, it bothers, and the same people and the frustration levels start building. So I think the solution to the growing number, of course, we are a highly populated nation, but we are also a country that has a lot of litigation which is pending. So the burden is high. And while it can be remedied by effectively and implementing the alternative dispute resolution mechanisms, these can address to a large extent the number of cases which are getting filed every day. And there is the issue of the backlog, which seems to be plaguing our system since very many years. Now, in our quest to provide a fair and free trial to all parties in India, the time that is needed for one matter to conclude is rather long. And it will take years before you get a judgment or a decree. Then you have the multi-layered appellate procedure. And then you have the execution thereof. So I think justice delayed is justice denied. And that is the bitter truth. And I want to quote eminent lawyer Nani Palkiwala, who had once remarked, if I were asked to mention the greatest drawback of the administration of justice in India today, I would say that it is delay. Our cases drag over a length of time, which makes eternity intelligible. The law may or may not be an ass, but in India, it is certainly a snail. Justice has to be blind, but I see no reason why it should be lame. How powerful was that? And This coming from an eminent lawyer of his standing shows you what delay can do to the entire system, to a litigant. Now, moving forward to current times. Now, 2020 was challenging globally for all institutions. Our legal system was also severely impacted. And although I firmly believe our judiciary did a stupendous job of rising to the challenges before it, it moved on to a virtual platform. It has ensured that litigants still have the ability to knock at their door and get relief. But this pandemic and these times have also meant that the cases that were being disposed of were reduced by half. So if the actual numbers have been compared and the data from the national judicial grid shows that in 2020, the high courts were able to dispose of less than a half as many cases as they did in 2019. But the number of the cases that were being filed, interestingly, fell only by a third. Now, what does that mean? That means that there is also an increase in the total number of pending cases, even for this period. Now, at present, the High Court has about 5.8 million pending cases. So the number of cases that will be disposed of in a year will always be less than those that are being instituted. And so we are stuck with a problem that keeps mounting. And like I mentioned briefly earlier, what does this actually mean for the litigant? It can mean that if you've challenged a violation of your fundamental right, that question is not being addressed for many. In a criminal case, you could be awaiting a verdict while you're waiting in the jail for a long period of time. It also, I think, directly affects our economic growth, because when companies are coming into the country, they want to have contractual enforcement done in a timely, quick manner. And when it becomes inordinately delayed and expensive, it can often be meaningless. Unfortunately, the delays are not just restricted to the courts, but it also extends to our tribunals. The government, thankfully, is taking a lot of steps in the correct direction, with more appointments coming quick and fast. But apart from the judicial strength, which according to me is a prime factor, there are other reasons for the delay in litigation. Like I mentioned, the appellate and the revisions, the procedural shackles, and the system itself, because it is adversarial in nature. These all compound the problem further. Now, in this backdrop, I feel that in the current scenario, the alternative dispute resolution will be a shining beacon of light, and it is a chance for lawyers to be able to provide quick access to justice to their clients. The long drawn process of litigation, costs incurred by parties, the limitation on the number of the judges, the adjudicators, they've all made ADR an important aspect of the judicial system, which one has hoped will ensure swifter and speedier justice. Now, like I mentioned, they will provide a quick resolution to the parties, and also parties have a direct control over the outcome. Personal relationships, which in a court environment get destroyed, can also be preserved. So in July 2021, the Honorable Chief Justice had said that mediation should be made mandatory as a first step for dispute resolution, and a law should be framed in this regard. Now, let us see whether or not that comes about, but I will discuss with you now what is the broad framework and what all does ADR encapsulate. So given the scope, the ADR resolution consists of arbitration, mediation, conciliation, negotiation. And any of these methods can be used to arrive at an out-of-court settlement. But each of these is slightly distinct and different, and therefore you need to broadly know what the difference is. I also forgot to mention, Lok Adalat is also one of the forms. So let me talk about the Lok Adalat first. In our country, I think historically, where there is a large population which is illiterate. So it is a very old, this was something that was a necessity to my mind. And Lok Adalat actually as a concept is something that was known to our Indian society, where you had disputes being dissolved through mediation by the elderly people in the village. And today, Lok Adalat is the form where you have a retired judge who will be sitting, presiding as the chairman with two other members who are usually either a senior lawyer, a social worker, or a lawyer. The huge advantage here is that there is no court fee. If the case is already filed in the regular court, the fee is in fact refunded to the claimant. If the matter gets resolved through the Lok Adalat, and the decision of the Lok Adalat is binding on the parties to the dispute. It is capable of execution through a legal process. And courts are also encouraging mediation at a pre-litigation stage in both civil and criminal matters. Now, this scenario includes arbitration. Now, arbitration, I think everyone would be familiar with, but just to quickly try and bring out the finer distinction between the various ADR mechanisms which are available. So in an arbitration, the dispute will be resolved by an impartial third party whose decision is then acceptable to both the parties. But in an arbitration, there needs to be a pre-existing arbitration agreement, which refers it to the third party for its determination. The determination is in the form of an award. So the Arbitration Act of 1940 had been passed earlier, but it had several loopholes and there were problems, and it could not be fully implemented in the manner that it had been envisaged. So until a few years ago, arbitration practice in India, unfortunately, instead of reducing the time span, was actually just one more inning in the game. So, and arbitration practice was treated as something that the lawyers did after court hours. So it was an extra thing that you could have done after court hours. You did not typically have hearing during court hours because there was no arbitration bar as such. This situation has thankfully changed. And so now you don't have the very short durations of the sessions. Today you find full-fledged hearings, with the entire day being set off for a hearing. So that is something very, very positive that came about after the 2015 amendment had been passed. So again, the arbitration award is final. It is binding. The appeal provisions are minimal. And every arbitration award will not be entertained admitted at the appellate stage. You have evidence, you have lawyers who appear for you, you have complete pleadings, but it is fast-tracked. So sometimes, of course, the arbitrator's fee can be an issue, but that we will leave for discussion on another day. But traditionally, as compared to the other ADRs, yes, arbitration is more expensive because as compared to a mediation or a conciliation proceeding, the final decision making is with the arbitrator who will who pronounces the award. Moving on to mediation. Now, the basic motive of mediation basically is it gives a window to the parties who have an opportunity to converse and explore options aided by a neutral third party to see if a settlement is possible. So mediation is the process by which an independent neutral person is there, and he is known as the mediator. He intervenes. And he works with the parties to try and find a solution which is acceptable to all of them. Now, in our system, this is not something that is alien, because it was there in the village panchayats where this was done for many, many years. In India, there are nearly 43,000 mediation centers. And since 2005, nearly 3.22 million cases have been referred and nearly 1 million cases have been settled up to March 2021. So the results are also very promising. Then the third one would be conciliation. In conciliation, it is again a neutral person who meets with the parties in the hope to see whether the dispute at hand can be resolved. The third party facilitates communication between parties with the aim that he will attempt to try and reconcile and settle their differences. The attempt to conciliate is generally, very broadly speaking, based on each side. The conciliator will show the contrary aspects of the dispute in order to bring both the parties closer to a solution, and then ultimately ensuring that parties reach a solution. The next one is negotiation. Now, negotiation is basically a communication process to again resolve conflicts. Compared to the processes which use mutual third parties, in a negotiation, it allows the parties themselves to control the process and the solution. Again, it is a voluntary exercise. If it fails, it is non-binding. You can control advantages that you have control over the outcome of the procedure, of how much time you're going to spend. You maximize your gains, and you can explore a wide range of possibilities and solutions. So in India, negotiation at the moment does not have any statutory recognition, because it is self-counseling which is done between the parties to resolve their disputes. Now, some of the statutory provisions which recognize and promote ADR. Now, the Arbitration and Conciliation Act itself notes that the court can at any point in either a Section 9 or 11 proceeding or in a 34-37, if they feel that it is possible that a settlement can be arrived at, will refer the matter to settlement. The entire conciliation process is governed by the Part 3 of the Act, which actually gives teeth to the entire process, because once a conciliation agreement is arrived at between the parties, then it again becomes executable as if it were a decree of the court. Then the CPC, that has laid down that and has gone a long way, according to me, to encourage parties to go for ADR. Now, that is Section 89. One of the CPC, which we'll just discuss. So I don't know. Globally, what you find is that over 90% of cases are actually settled out of court. And only when a resolution is not reached, the parties then go to trial. Now, our CPC under the Section 89 also envisages that where it appears to the court that there is a element or a possibility of a settlement that may be acceptable to the, both the parties that are before it, then the court itself then formulates the broad settlement. Then it will give you an opportunity to go back and you can come back to the court and the court can again reframe that and then refer it to one of the ADR rules. So the idea over here is that before the commencement of the proceedings itself or at the stage, initial stage itself, it gets referred to a ADR mechanism. So you are not suffering through the entire process and not spending that much time, energy, effort. You don't feel that frustration. Historically, our code earlier also had a provision, but when the 1940 Arbitration Act came in, that was repealed. And then it was brought, because at that time it was felt that with the 1940 Act coming in, there would have been no need for the Section 89. But then it was brought back by an amendment in 1999 to again try and resolve the disputes without going to the trial phase. And this was done pursuant to the Malimut Committee report and the Law Commission of India. Now, the Section 89 talks about all the four alternate resolution forums. So it could be an arbitration, it could be, but in an arbitration, of course, you take a private party, and then the decision is binding on the parties, and both parties have to agree. Whereas in the other three mediums, there is party autonomy in the final decision till at least the final decision is arrived at. And arbitration in our country is at the moment the most sought after and very, very popular. And the others have yet not become that popular. But over a period of time, I feel that they are going bound to be on the rise. And like I said, arbitration is only available if there is consent of the parties. Otherwise, it is not within the power of the court to refer it to the arbitration. In the, if supposing one party were to consent and the other doesn't, then you cannot, the court cannot refer it for arbitration. In the case of AFCON's infrastructure versus Chirayan Varke, which is a landmark Supreme Court judgment of 2010, Supreme Court had laid down that basically the broad principles which governed the principles for referring pending disputes to ADR. So there it was held that parties' consent is mandatory only for referring the dispute to arbitration or conciliation, and not for the other modes, including mediation, conciliation, etc., including mediation. Then one more section, which is Order 32, Rule A, a duty has been cast upon the courts that it shall make an endeavor to assist parties in the very first instance in arriving at a settlement in respect of the subject matter of the suit, where these are matters which relate to family matters. So those could be matrimonial or property relating to the family or maintenance or legitimacy, etc. Then another very pertinent one is the amendment which was done to the Commercial Courts Act, where pre-institution mediation and settlement was introduced in 2018. And this attempts to resolve the differences out of court before a suit can be instituted. So where you feel that there is a possibility that something can be resolved without going to the court, or the difference between your perspective and the other parties is the gap is minimal, you can actually refer it to this pre-mediation. So I find this to be an extremely useful tool, which during the pandemic, I have used extensively also and have been advising clients. But, you know, in cases where you're filing a commercial suit, but and there you've also filed a prayer, an application seeking urgent interim relief, there you cannot have a reference to the pre-institution mediation. Of course, after the hearing or you have some sort of a status quo order, typically you find that matters do go at some point for the conciliation, which is not, again, mandatory. Now, I want to, Joseph Grinbaum, who's a renowned mediator, had said that an ounce of mediation is equal to a pound of arbitration and a ton of litigation. So that is how useful mediation as a tool can really be. Now, ADR is actually bearing very good fruits, and the number of the cases which are being referred in India have been on the increase. Now, whether, you know, it is a Lok Adalat or a mediation, a conciliation, I think as a lawyer, as people who are part of the system, we must contribute our bit to try and have an early resolution of the dispute. And I think there a huge role can be played, because it is not just about taking the minimum adjournments. You have to have a mindset that what you need to give to your client is a relief and a quick one. And so you can adopt these practices to get that for your client. So you need to be mindful and sensitive of the plight of your client, whose case is being marred by these delays and by this entire procedure, and there is no solution in sight. And, you know, few personal things which I have experienced, I would like to share here, because many times I have seen clients, and this is not just individuals, also companies, they give up some point in the middle of the entire period, because what has happened is that you got down, bogged down by the procedure, the cost, etc., which are part of our system. To share one instance, now there was a patent litigation which was going on. In the first three years, the client was there at every hearing. Proactively, we were, you know, trying to get him relief. But after about 20 odd court hearings and a roster change, and then start back going back to the starting point, now the client found himself that, you know, twice he had gone back to the starting line. And so it actually led to the smaller company compromising with the bigger company, because you can't sustain, and it also loses its significance ultimately if you don't get relief initially, especially in IPR matters. Now, another similar situation where there was a court battle of two international competitors in a FMCG, where it was about their trade dress, and an interim injunction was sought against my client. And since none had been forthcoming, ultimately those parties and the dispute got resolved. So sometimes you find that ADR tools are being used out of frustration. So that is what can change if we as lawyers, and we use all these processes which the government, you know, the legislations have put in place, and we try and do that at the inception and that stage rather than later. Coming to personal disputes, you know, you find custody battles, matrimonial matters, which run for many, many years, and, you know, parties are not being able to restart. But ultimately, you know, and I think the worst that I've seen is a matrimonial dispute that ran over 18 years. And then ultimately it did get resolved in the mediation itself, but left a very, very bitter taste. And all of that could have also been resolved if ADR had been resorted to. Now, some people, of course, continue to litigate out of ego, out of a sense that they've been wrong. Again, that is something that mediation can address, because you are heard. You will also be heard in an isolated environment as and when required. So there is an ongoing matter which I'm handling, where the first court decree was in 1986, and two generations later, they are still at loggerheads and in court litigating with no end in sight. So all of this is something that we need to deal with. But according to me, there is a silver line, which is this, that while 20 years ago when I started practice, more than 20 years now actually, so parties were willing to explore ADR as a last resort, as a last option. So all of these examples that I gave you are parties that resolved it through mediation and ADR or some ADR mechanism after feeling that sense of frustration. But today, companies and individuals alike, they are willing to explore ADR at the inception and not as the last resort. And my advice always when I'm meeting with a client is that if a settlement is a possibility, if it is something that can be arrived at with a little give and take, then that is the preferred route to take. And contrary, I'm sharing this very frankly with all of you who will become lawyers tomorrow. So this is contrary to the popular belief that this is counterproductive to a, in quotes, good practice, because ultimately the client also really appreciates that what was paramount in my lawyer's mind was my interest. And that will eventually help your reputation and goodwill as a lawyer. That very client will refer 10 more clients to you. And I absolutely and totally agree with Abraham Lincoln, who had once said, discourage litigation, persuade your neighbors to compromise whenever you can. Point out to them how the nominal winner is often a real loser in fees and waster of time. As a peacemaker, the lawyer has a superior opportunity of being a good man. There will still be business enough. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Meghna, for such an insightful and enlightening talk on ADR. I think all our listeners must have really understood what the concept means today and how it is different from the regular courts. And we are moving towards, taking great strides towards ADR today, because considering the number of pending cases in the High Court, I think the need of the hour is that we do settle matters outside the court. Definitely. Now, we could have some interactive session now, Meghna.
Absolutely, ma'am. And in fact, I see there is two questions the
Can I
Q&A?
Just read them out? Yeah, can I just
yes,
take
please.
Them out? Yeah. The first question is by Mahima Mahajan. She's a faculty member. She's asking, isn't intervention of courts causing a hindrance to the growth of ADR regime in India?
Well, I think the answer to that is both a yes and a no. But I think in the long term, it will have a very positive effect, because as more and more success is seen in matters which get referred, the ADR route and the ADR mechanism will gain, and more people will possibly opt out for that at the inception stage. At the moment, of course, we find, unfortunately, still that parties go for ADR after some time and not at the inception. So it will take, and I think to reach that, and this journey has to be done. So we, as a society, as lawyers, as people who are part of the system, until we all also start saying that ADR is something which needs to be actively looked at, we are actually then really relying upon the courts to push, encourage people to go for mediation and the other ADRs.
Thank you, Meghna. There's another question again by a faculty member, then I'll go to questions put by students.
Sure.
Arushi wants to know, the Supreme Court had recently suggested appointing young lawyers as arbitrators as a measure to bring down the overall cost of arbitration. Do you see this suggestion actually unfolding during your practice? And do you think this is an important change required for the future of arbitration in our country?
So, ma'am, I think the reason why this was done is an important one. And the Supreme Court, when it made the suggestion, has done so keeping in mind that today what is happening is we are relying mostly on the retired judges and for their time. So that is number one, expensive. And number two, there is just so many options which are available. So there will be disputes which the younger lawyers can deal with. So I'm not saying that every dispute there is a possibility of going through a young lawyer. But many, many arbitrations don't really need a retired Supreme Court judge or a high court or even our district courts. So where perhaps with some training can be made mandatory, some sort of a procedure can be brought in. I'm not saying, and I'm not in favor of simply some young lawyers being brought to the fore without understanding and the ability to actually deal with what happens in an arbitration, because that, this is also a contested proceeding. So there, like you have a training for mediators, so you have trained mediators across forums, you can have trained arbitrators. And once that is done, yes, I think it would be very positive and something that, again, because the cost is something that really keeps people from going for arbitration today. Because the arbitrator charges per session and you don't know how many sessions there will be. So sometimes that becomes a very huge amount. So with some training, why not? And I think, I see an entire bar coming, the arbitration bar, similarly a mediation bar, not just today, all of us, and I'm a litigating lawyer. So anyone who's doing arbitrations are also the same who were initially doing. Now, slowly, very slowly, there is a completely distinct bar for arbitration and people who arbitration. Slowly, that is coming about. I think it will be time consuming, maybe even more than 5 years, but let's see.
Good for the students. They have great prospects.
Yes, ma'am, this is here to stay. Mediation, arbitration, these are all things which are here to stay now.
Okay, Meghna, a few more questions.
Absolutely.
One question is, to what extent is ADR effective through online mode during pandemic? How effective has it been?
Extremely, especially because what is happening is that the court, because it is taking matters online, and online, it's taking longer for adjudication. So while earlier you had the entire being taken up, we are still struggling with the current list urgent matters of 2021. Last year, urgent matters of 2020. So your matter was not getting heard. Whereas if it went to a ADR mechanism, there you were getting hearings for the full day before an arbitrator, before the mediators. Again, long sessions. If we had one session today, the next session tomorrow itself. And also in the pandemic, I think the entire legal system, all of us as lawyers, we all had a little more time also, which was used fruitfully. I have personally done so much mediation online through the High Court Center. And in fact, one where, over 3 months was spent by the mediators on a almost day-to-day effort. So, and then when it's fruitful, then it's all worth it. So it's been very, very positive in the pandemic, especially.
Yeah, very good. Meghna, another important question which has come up is, how effective is ADR in family disputes, especially where a child is involved?
You know, ma'am, this is something which largely depends on, and in family matters especially, it's most important that parties go through the ADR route. Because especially where there's a child, you want to have something to do with the child throughout your life, and therefore dealing with your spouse with whom you are estranged. There the mediation route comes in very, very handy, because you don't want to vitiate things to that point that it is impossible. But there have also been instances where parties have huge ego issues, especially at the starting point. You are not willing to sort of budge, and you take a stand that you see you've been wronged, or you feel that you are the one who has been subjected to so much wrong. And then you don't want, I say this as a woman, you know, many times the woman feels that I don't now want to give access to the child. Court is bound to give visitation because the father equally has rights. And, you know, between the two of you, there could be bad blood and there could be a terrible relationship, but then both have rights as parents. So that thing, this aspect may not be appreciated by the client when told by the lawyer. But when the trained mediator sits one-to-one in a session, explains that ultimately this is what will happen, but things will keep getting worse as you keep litigating. So that's where in family matters, it is crucial and most important that parties go to through the ADR route. And in fact, in almost, unless you know there's some interim, some urgent relief to be sought, pre-litigation, conciliation, mediation route is very, very effective for family matters, including those of property settlement.
Yeah, I think here it is important for a psychologist to be present, you know, because for the child and even for the parents, you know, their conduct towards the child, because it's a very, very delicate situation. And I think the psychologist should be made mandatory.
So our family courts actually have trained mediators, psychologists. They have a family, our high court. There's a nice room where the child can even play. There are situations where things are so bad that you cannot meet outside. Sometimes mediators actually even go that far to get the child there and have the first meeting and the ice broken. And they really take the pains to do this. And they are very well trained and they undergo rigorous training, including how to deal with marriages where such difficulties arise.
Yeah. Thank you, Meghna. There are some more questions. I hope you have the time to...
Well, please, I'm going.
There's another question which says, can mediation and arbitration be combined?
Well, arbitration, like I said, ma'am, is a very formal route. So sometimes what happens is in the course of the arbitration, parties can indicate that there is a possibility of some sort of a settlement. So the arbitrator then informally may start acting as a mediator, but formally, I have not seen a reference to a mediation separately to a mediation center while an arbitration was going on. But I have seen several times parties arriving at a settlement in the course of the arbitration, nudged by the arbitrator.
Thank you. Now, how is ADR useful in criminal cases? I remember you just said it in your talk. I'm intrigued by it. This is my question, Meghna. Okay, because I feel in criminal matters, how can you actually resolve disputes through ADR, you know, especially when they are non-compoundable offenses?
It's not personal. Yes. So, no, again, now this is more in the realm of, you know, matrimonial matters where dowry complaints, cruelty cases have been filed, or you have filed a complaint with the CAW. There, once a settlement is arrived at the center or through mediation or sometimes even intervention of friends and family, then that is used in the quashing and then everything is withdrawn. You're absolutely right. That process is, of course, against the state. So those formal formalities still need to be done. But then this settlement is placed on record in those proceedings, and then everything gets withdrawn. Similar to, ma'am, any matrimonial dispute, which ultimately, you know, you file a divorce by mutual consent, for example. So then you mention that there are these proceedings and those will be withdrawn and parties will sort of cooperate with each other to withdraw whatever sort of complaints and cases have been filed. Also in property cases, ma'am, I find that families these days don't hesitate to file criminal complaints against each other.
So maybe small matters could be decided, very small matters, yes. No?
Hmm. Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
You know, this is again an extension to the question that I just asked you regarding ADR in family matters. There's a student by the name of Ashish Kumar. He says, ma'am, according to your experience, what's best for a family dispute? Arbitration or a court settlement?
A court settlement through the mediation center or a pre-litigation mediation or a conciliation process. Simply because, as opposed to an arbitrator who has to follow the procedure of evidence, of trial, of pleadings, the main thrust and aim of a conciliator or a mediator is to just bridge that gap. So the entire focus then lies there. So if you haven't already commenced an arbitration, feel there is any possibility, then definitely you should go for this. In fact, many arbitration clauses always have that failing a mediation being successful, or you know, you spend 30 days or 60 days, depending on the clause. But that is normally just given by the companies as we tried to mediate and that period is over. So I think that again needs to be given better credence to even by courts.
Yeah. So, you know, I feel that maybe mediation would be a little better than arbitration in the sense that there is more sensitivity involved and the resolution comes from the parties themselves.
Yes.
You know,
absolutely.
Yeah. So, yeah.
And I'm now with the amendment, there is a 1 year plus 6 months. So within 18 months, there is also pressure on the arbitrator to commence and then conclude with the award. So if you're going to then in the middle start a mediation process, which can again be 2 to 3 months, then it's difficult to be on both the boards, you know, for the arbitrator. So therefore, absolutely agree with you there, ma'am. Mediation would be a better process to follow.
Can we have a legislation for mediation, Meghna? Because India doesn't have a legislation yet.
So that's what, ma'am, the Chief Justice has said, that this is something that needs to be looked at. And going by the very positive steps government has been taking, you know, there are so many judges who've been made in the last couple of months. There is a amendment to our resolution process, NCLT is being revamped. So I think all of this would also be something in the pipeline. But you know, these are also legislations which will take some time. Even after they are passed, for the entire, all the members were there. So not just the lawyers, the litigants, the judges, everyone has to then imbibe and change their approach to ADR also.
Yeah, there's another question one of the faculty members wants to know, whether mediation will also fall into the trap of procedural nuances once we have a statute on mediation in India.
that's going to be crucial that we somehow enact it in such a manner that it doesn't, because absolutely correct, because that's what happened when the first Arbitration Act in 1940 came. It was just a series and another series and it went on and on. But I think now we have been through, you see, we were a young country which didn't know how things would. And now we have internationally, we are seeing, and we will, I'm sure, adopt best practices. And because in our country now, especially across the bigger cities, the mediation bar is very active. So the participants will be able to share their experiences. And hopefully when the legislation comes, they will take into account all of that. But that said, anything that comes through legislation, they will then require some sort of an appellate forum. Maybe it would again be very minimal, like our Arbitration Act, you know, you can't appeal on anything. And you discourage appeals. So let's see how that pans out. But yes, let's keep our fingers crossed and stay positive, because like I said, ma'am, in the last 20 years, you know, when I started litigation, in the first 5 years, I had seen no ADR. And during the pandemic, I have seen so many cases resolved by mediation center, by conciliation. And also, I think because of the current economic situation, nobody wants to now go start a litigation that's going to go on for the next 15 years. No one wants to lock the money. You need to take action here and now. So,
and you know, when we talk about access to justice includes quick justice, not justice buried, but then quick justice, not for 15 and 20 years, as is happening. Yeah. There's another question, Meghna. What type of disputes would be suited for online dispute resolution in India? Again, a faculty member has asked this question. What kind of disputes would you?
So family, of course, we discussed, definitely. But according to me, even commercial disputes where the gap isn't too large. So if it's not black and white, if you are not two ends of the spectrum, then even a commercial dispute can little give and take. And you always have that sense that what is the other party saying and what you are saying. So, and that's where I think that 89 discretion, which is there with the courts, is very crucial, because many times, and this we find in the High Court also, when parties are arguing and the judges say, but the gap is not so much, so why are you not trying to settle? So that's where we are.
Another question is, can mediation be fruitful in cases involving disputes of senior citizens, or would it merely prolong the proceedings?
No, mediation is not a long drawn process at all. So it also depends on what is the relief that the senior citizen requires. So if it is in terms of monetary relief or finding a place to live, or is it a disposal of an asset? So a disposal of an asset would necessarily take longer time. So that would be slightly long drawn. But none of the ADR processes are as long drawn as a adversarial court case, because like I said, ma'am, first you need to go through the entire process of the trial for the decree. Then you need to again start the process for execution thereof. So there are actually two battles that you're fighting. And God forbid, if you lose in the first round, then you go to the appeal, and sometimes the appeal can then send you right back to reappreciate evidence. So it does become long.
Very right. Now, because, you know, I've done a few arbitration cases, Meghna, myself. You know, I'm with ICA. So, but somewhere they do get technical. But, you know, being a teacher, I was very sensitive to all these things. And it was more of a mediation kind of thing, you know, which I did experience. But of course, I had to go into the technicalities of law. Now, mediation, as you see it in India today, it is not open for teachers. You know, I've always, at seminars, conferences, I've always made this point that why can't teachers, law teachers, be mediators also? Because teachers are very sensitive usually, because they're dealing with students. So they have a lot of psychology in their dealings, the way they talk and the way they address the students, you know, in every walk of life. And mediation requires that. I remember at a conference, yes, when I was speaking, I did raise this point. And Professor Madhav Menon took it very positively. And he spoke from the, you know, from the mic, and he said that why not mediation for teachers? Because I've been wanting to do this course, but I think the Delhi High Court says no, only lawyers. So this has to be changed, I feel.
Yes, and in fact, that would be very welcome, because the more the number of trained people that we can get on board, the larger the number of disputes that can be resolved through this process.
Yes.
It is not something that had struck me ever until you said mentioned this. This is a very, very relevant. In fact, we must encourage more and more people coming forward. And because if you involve teachers, then also geographically the reach could be really large. So that would be very positive.
Yeah. I think something all of you should do it, and maybe one could write a couple of articles on this.
Definitely. It's a thought to take forward.
Yeah, really, Meghna. Meghna, it's been a wonderful session, really.
So
and, you know, it's been an eye-opener for all of us, even the faculty members. And we would love to have you again with us, maybe in person, if it is possible, in the coming months, so that we can, you know, share our ideas and opinions physically. And we'll also get the opportunity of serving you well and with all our warmth and affection. Because NorthCap University, I just joined last year. It's a lovely campus. It's a beautiful campus. So you must visit it. And we'll see.
I will definitely love to come. It's been a lovely time. My pleasure, absolutely. And of course, thank you so much, ma'am, for hosting you. And I repeat, it's wonderful to be on the same platform.
It's wonderful to see you, Meghna.
Thank you, sir.
And also on behalf of the management and the entire community, students, everybody, teachers, I wholeheartedly thank you for being us with today. Yeah? Thank you so much.